Assez! And geez, every time I come here, it never gets old for me. I just love it. And I've been coming here since my very first CD, Won't Ellie, in 2000. And I'm back for the fifth one, The Spirit Indestructible. This is beautiful. I came to London on a backpacking trip when I was 18. We spent a lot of time feeding the pigeons at Trafalgar Square. We thought we were really cool and realized we probably looked like these tourists climbing on all the statues at Trafalgar Square. I feel like culturally, it's a music-friendly environment. I started out in the Toronto scene, you know, doing trip-hop music when I was about 17, and there were opportunities to play open mic, get out, meet people, be a part of the musical community. I think London also nurtures that musical community, and from musical community comes great things. It feels good to be here again. I mean, I enjoyed each and every trip to England over the course of my career. Since the very beginning, right up until now, my fifth album, so I feel lucky. I feel lucky that I can keep coming back and share this new one, The Spirit Indestructible.
Through my 1 square foot window, I see inside. I've got chains on my feet, but out of my mind.
Spirit Indestructible is the name of my album, so the title track is called Spirit Indestructible, and that song is very much about believing in the future, believing in humanity, and believing that we all have this power within us that we don't always access, but is very much there. And at times I do like to write these anthems that are about empowerment, so I like those songs that kind of move you in that way, and I've had a really great couple of years where I've been lucky enough to experience some really, really amazing things, you know, traveling to Africa and meeting all these great communities and people and families and young people that just seem so hopeful about the future. And I think I'm looking at the world in a new way, and so I really wanted to put that positivity on the album as a whole, but also on Spirit Indestructible particularly. I grew up playing instruments. I played the ukulele as a child, and then I started playing trombone. So I spent a large part of my youth playing in bands. And the whole idea, when you play in a group setting, you learn that music is about community, collaboration, exploration, movement, imperfection, the constant quest for perfection that doesn't exist in music. So for me, I try to transfer that belief into my pop albums, in that you should never stop searching. You should never stop searching within your musicality. You should never stop expressing your musicality. And you should be fearless.
Spirit in
side of being an artist that does entail a lot of pressure, because at the end of the day, especially for me, because I am signed to like a major record label, so it's given me great opportunity in my career. It's enabled me to reach fans across the world. You know, I just got back from Asia, where, you know, from Taiwan to Tokyo, you know, I saw people singing back "I'm Like a Bird" at me, for instance, and it's phenomenal, and I would have never achieved that alone without a great record company behind me. So I really feel like the dividends that creativity pays are really, really, truly valuable. I've had fans come back to me with albums from the past that maybe haven't sold as well as others, but there's something special that draws them to me as a career artist. So I think those things aren't quite finite, and I think you really have to judge the creativity first. When I started making this album, no one kind of, besides for me, knew how many songs I had, because I just quietly worked away with friends, you know, all these different people, producers and writers that I have been writing with over the years, and kind of really tried to A&R the album myself for 2 years. Then I realized it got way too overwhelming, because I lost track of how many songs I had. I had like 60 songs, and then I was like, when I met Rodney Jerkins, I was like, okay, all right, let's finish this thing. And we just did these 8 tracks that I was thrilled about, and we combined them with all the best from all the other collabos, and he helped me executive produce album and choose a song, so it's nice to have help too. It's my 5th baby, musical baby, and it means more than ever, really. I think I've come full circle since the first one 12 years ago, so you know, they say you have your whole life to write your first album, and I feel like I've lived a lifetime since that one came out, so it feels good. There are a lot of upbeat numbers that are just really about having I don't know, I was in a really raw kind of creative space where I just really wanted an album that was kind of propulsive and energetic and full of adrenaline and rough around the edges, imperfect, you know, I just wanted that sound. And Parking Lot's quite an irreverent kind of song, inspired by this idea of kind of hanging out with your friends in the parking lot on a lazy evening, you know, and hoping to see, you know, that special someone that maybe you have a crush on or that, and going and just it catches it. It has a summer vibe in a way, but really, I grew up in a small town, so we hung out in a lot of parking lots. So I really was able to kind of pull from a place in my mind that's quite nostalgic on this album. I think that comes with growth. You're able to kind of embrace all the wonderful moments of childhood and express that in your songs. All my friends that it's pretty casual. They turn a green one and receive me while I'm riding with ya, with ya, with ya. Depending on the minute and depending on the hour. Hey. Yeah, the album's really eclectic. It's kind of like a, geez, it's like a bazaar of sounds, and the collaborations aren't, you know, your run-of-the-mill collabos. So I've got the Kenyan Boys Choir, Sarah Tavares, who's a singer from Portugal. I've got a brand new rapper who's 16 called Ace Primo. I've got Nas. It's really eclectic, and I love that about it, because I love meeting new producers and new artists. It's just the thrill for me. It's the challenge that I love.
Slippery,
better. Big Ben.
That's gorgeous. Oh my goodness. Check out the London Eye. I've never been on that. Can we stop? Excuse me. One of my greatest pleasures in life is driving around listening to music. I just love listening to music in my car. It's a favorite, my favorite place. I always love leaving the studio and then blasting it and seeing if what I've created, you know, is as good or exciting as I thought it was in the studio when I created it. Because sometimes it's different, you know. When you're alone in your car, you really kind of get some perspective. I feel like songs are like babies, you know. And so they're precious to you. I feel like they're only your songs when you write them, within those hours, days, you know. And then they become yours in a small circle of friends and family. But then when you release the album, they become everybody's songs. It's hard because it's almost like your baby's turned 18 and then there goes off into the world. And you have no control over if people like it or hate it or trash it or it repulses them or they fall in love with it. And it's wonderfully vulnerable, wildly vulnerable. So it makes you feel quite alive. Another new song we'll be playing is Big Hoops, Bigger the Better. That was my first kind of feeler single from this album. And that song as well taps into that youthful kind of id and just kind of like takes you to this place where it's my tribute to hip hop and R&B, which was my musical preference at about 14, 15 years of age. You know, I used to put on my sister's big hoop earrings and, you know, go to the jam and listen to this hip hop and R&B. And I'd sometimes kind of steal the microphone from the DJ at the party and I'd grab it and freestyle and sing for everybody. And I always felt such confidence on the mic. So in that song, I'm kind of making reference to the fact that when you're on the microphone, you have to have confidence. The bigger the confidence, the better, and the bigger the attitude, the better. In developing new talent. I always wanted my own label, but I guess I didn't get around to it till 4 years ago. I released my Spanish album on my own label, which was really rewarding. The album ended up winning a Latin Grammy, which was beyond my wildest dreams. Write a song, that moment of creativity is, it's almost sacred, at least to you, you know, because something's been born. And it's a great feeling, I mean. Like when a baby's been born, it's the greatest day of your life. Live, though, is the affirmation. You know, when you sing the songs live, you get to see what the song turned into for other people. You get to feel, perhaps, what the song means to them when you look out into the crowd and see them reacting to it. So it's twofold. So for me, I think artists, especially new artists in general, and I had the same struggle at most with live performance. I think the hardest thing to do as an artist, especially as a new artist,
is satisfy yourself and satisfy your audience at the same time and not be too selfish, you know? Because that's the push and pull between you and your audience. So in that goes the same for concert or how you make your albums or whatever you do. So yeah, there's always this push and pull, and you can withdraw into yourself or you can find that balance. And that's the hardest thing to navigate. I'm like a bird.
My father had this record player, sort of this amazing record player, and I was kind of obsessed with the thing. I just kind of put on all his records, which ranged from the Beatles to Blondie to ABBA to even the Village People. So he kind of had everything. And then I got really into Britpop. And then I got really into different specific artists like Jeff Buckley, Prince, Mary J. Blige, and then Caetano Veloso. So Brazilian music was a big influence. I have a lot of influences. I started writing songs when I was 12, and I really wanted to know what that life was like. And I enjoyed singing on stage from the age of four, and I knew immediately that I liked making people happy, and I liked kind of sharing emotions and energy with them. So, you know, when Bonelli came out, I just couldn't believe how quickly everything happened, you know. All of a sudden I was on, you know, big, huge TV shows and big tours, and it was really great. And then, you know, it really surprised me when Loose came out, and then it was even bigger than Bonelli. That was a surprise. I'm truly in shock that it's been 12 years. It just sounds like such a long time, but it doesn't feel like a long time. It really doesn't. It feels like just yesterday I held my Spirit Indestructible CD in my hands just the other day for the first time ever. And I actually went right back to the moment that I held Bonelli in my hands, and it was just as pure. You know, I still feel the same way about music. I'm still just as passionate. I'm still just as in love with making records. So that I'm really grateful for. Yeah, I find I've been lucky enough to, in my everyday life, I have managed to live a relatively normal life. When I go on tour and at work, I'm reminded of how kind of crazy it can be. I still do really regular things. I mean, I like hanging out in strange coffee shops and libraries, graveyards, depends.
Did a song in Portuguese actually with Andrea Bocelli. We recorded Corcovado, and it's going to come out on Valentine's Day, so that's exciting. It's for his album. But I like to dabble in other genres in the future. I mean, I've got all kinds of music on my mind, whether it's Portuguese music, another Spanish one, perhaps a true world music album, perhaps a jazz album in the future. I don't know, but I'm always tinkering, thinking of the next crazy thing. It's been a great ride. Probably the moments where I rediscover my creativity have been the finest moments. I think being in the studio with Rodney Jerkins was amazing, because I found another thing, you know, inside that I hadn't felt for a while. And also winning the Latin Grammy with Mi Plan was fantastic. It felt like a dream. It was really surreal. And it proved to me that when you make music from the heart and you follow your musical path, your true musical path, you always find an audience. I can't say that I don't love the light and the dark. I can't say that I don't know the day and the light. And I love what I feel I can show.
another brick that I laid from my body. I could show you a place. God knows you should know.